And thank you for having me today. Again, I'm JJ Wei from Minan University, and I'm going to talk about the magnetic soft robots and the micropillar arrays. Okay, to begin with, to briefly introduce my university. It's located in Incheon area, and it's number one university in Incheon and number eight in South Korea. And we are specialized particularly in engineering school. And it's only 30 minutes from Incheon International Airport, which is the place you'll be in Korea for the first time. So if you stop by Korea, please don't forget stop by Incheon University. Okay, I guess most of you guys already heard about soft robotics. And the reason why we care about soft robotics is because unlike the conventional robotic systems, which is hard, rigid, and very strong, it can investigate the other regime, which is very soft and delicate. So in case of conventional robotic systems, if we try to touch and hold very small object and very vulnerable object like a living ant or one tiny fish egg, it's very hard to not damage them. But in case of soft robot, in this case, it's a silicone rubber, PDMS, and by having air inlet and outlet, it can have actuation in this soft robot so that it can grab a fish egg or grabbing living ant without crushing them. So soft robot has a specialty to control vulnerable object with soft interfaces. So people try to investigate soft robotics with different power sources. So the first example was the air inlet and outlet, which is the pneumatic system. So it can actuate robotic systems and grab small vulnerable object. And also people can use hydrogel or magnetic system as well, which will be my topic today, and or light or electrical signal. But as you can see, if we go to smaller soft robotic systems, it's harder to put any wire connectivity. So in case of pneumatic system, it's easier to control meter scale or centimeter scale. But if we go to micron scale or even smaller, wire connectivity is very hard. So different powering systems have different regimes. So my talk will be focused on contactless manipulation of miniaturized soft robotics by using magnetic field. Recently, there has been lots of attention in magnetic soft robots. So 2018, 2019, and even 20, there are various soft robotic systems that can be operated in even in blocked systems. Because magnetic field doesn't have any problem to penetrate even in the blocked system, people try to utilize it in non-surgical robotic systems. Or non-surgical drug delivery or endoscopy, something like that. And it can work in ambient condition. We don't have to heat it up. So in case of body, we cannot heat greater than 40 degrees C because of worrying about the damaging the protein. But in case of this robotic system by magnetic field, it doesn't increase the temperature. And we don't have to use solvent. And if we utilize magnetic field by having multi-axial control, then we can have a complicated locomotion of this robotic system. But even though it has very promising result, most of the examples are showing single soft robot control because it's very hard to control the magnetic field in different patterns. But recently, people tried to have collective behaviors by operating multiple robots to achieve a mutual goal. So in this case, different robotic systems are shown for battery system or some conventional robotic systems. But in case of soft robot, there has been not much examples because of complexity of control by utilizing magnetic field. So I'm going to talk about this collective behaviors in magnetic soft robot. We are inspired by the multi-planet in solar system. So in our solar system, there are 8 different planets and they have different size and different orbit radius and speed. And they have different size as well. And they have a hierarchical motility, which is rotating and revolving at the same time. So my motivation was, as a polymer engineer, how to generate hierarchical rotation and revolution motion with magnetic field, but with a single magnetic field to control multi-object. To starting with, this is the magnetic particle I utilized. I chose the iron oxide nanoparticles. They are super ferrimagnetic. So this nanoparticle has a very small size. Usually nanoparticles less than 20 nanometer or 50 nanometer, they work as a super paramagnetism. They have a super paramagnetism, unlike the normal magnet. If they are just ferromagnet, they will have coercivity, but because of the larger Brownian motion than the magnetic momentum, for this small magnetic particle, they can randomize the magnetic momentum so that they work as a super paramagnet. So this is the size of the magnetic nanoparticle here. Hydrodynamic diameter is about 13.7 nanometer. And even in case of Z average diameter, by weighting more for larger particles, it still has 16 nanometer in diameter. And polydispersity is only 0.06, so it's quite monodispersed. We disperse this iron oxide nanoparticles within thermoplastic polyurethane. Because this is TPU, thermoplastic, it can be dissolved in a solvent. We utilize the THF, which is a mutual solvent for iron oxide and this TPU. And then we mix them together by having a gentle sonication for 5 minutes, and then rapidly precipitate it in a common non-solvent to have this good dispersion of nanoparticles. This is important because in case of microparticle systems, we can simply dry up solvent. Then because the microsystems, we have large particle-particle distance, and by the evaporating solvent, it will increase the viscosity of the solution. Then this particle will have very slow translational diffusion and then end up with immobilized at the position there. But in case of nanoparticle, they have very close nanoparticle distance between them. So it has very easy aggregation tendency. Also, the diffusion is also dependent to the particle size. Small nanoparticles diffuse much faster, and we end up with large macroscopic phase separation for nanocomposite system. But because we have good dispersion in solution case, we have very large particle-particle distance. And then by rapidly precipitating in a non-solvent, polymer dimension will be collapsed so that it can capture nanoparticles within it, so that it can provide entropical repulsion layer on it, and then we can have this good dispersion. And this is a TEM image showing the homogeneous dispersion. Even though we have some clustering behavior, but we don't have any macroscopic phase separation. And because of that homogeneous dispersion, we don't have any large speckles in this picture, and the nanocomposite film becomes transparent. And you can read the letter in a university behind it. Okay, we prepared the three-dimensional helical soft robot by using the two-dimensional film. After the rapid precipitation, we have precipitant pellet, and then we put them together by placing in a hot plate and then press it with a regulated spacing. So we can control the thickness. And as you can see, this transparent film is twisted 180 degree and then repeated three times. And then 30 times it caused the super twisting like this. And then to remove this super twisting, we stretch it out. And then because it's just the grabbed by the tweezer, we change the shape by heating up to 175 degrees C and then cool it down to room temperature so that we smooth out this roughness into this regular helical soft robot. And then because it's crunched, we can fix the shape. And we cut into different aspect ratio from 1 to 5 to have this helical soft robot. And this is the result. We have less than 1 millimeter length and diameter as well. And this is three-dimensional helical system made from the twisting two-dimensional film. And because we super twisted and then stretched it out, there's no void inside it. If we don't have enough twisting, we found that it has void in it. And when we have magnetic rotation, because of this void, it could not have very good locomotion. But in case of this densely packed helical soft robot, we have good locomotion behaviors. For actuation, we simply utilize the hot plate that has magnetic starter. We don't use the hot plate function, but just use this magnetic starter function. So by simply changing the this RPM below this stage, we have the linearly connected to magnet, permanent magnet, and it rotates. So once it rotates, this magnetic soft robot, for sure, it will follow this clockwise rotation. But as I showed you before, it's three-dimensional helical system. So during the rotation, the center of mass has a little bit of offset from the origin. So it generates the outward centrifugal force until these centrifugal forces canceled out by this magnetic attraction at the center. The magnet is only at the center. That's why it has magnetic attraction towards the center part. So this soft robot started from the origin, but it goes outward until it meets the force balance between the centrifugal force and magnetic attraction. So once force balance is met, it will just keep the same orbital radius with the same speed as well. But important thing is this magnet is linearly connected like this. This is the side view. So we have soft robot on this height. And below that, we have two magnets connected linearly. And there are magnetic field like this. So at the origin, we have parallel magnetic field. But as soft robot goes to outward, the magnetic field direction has a little bit of tilt. And then if we go further, we have larger tilt angle. That means if we move the soft robot from the center to outward, then we have lifting angle. It starts from zero, but then it will have larger increase for lifting angle. And then it depends on the aspect ratio of the soft robot, even though we have general trend of going up. So this magnetic field can be visualized by utilizing magnetic viewing film. So under this magnetic viewing film, we can see parallel magnetic field as a bright color here. And at the outward direction, we have perpendicular magnetic field shown as dark. So if we rotate this magnet, soft robot goes up and up. And then we have different locomotion behavior. And important thing is magnetic field strength, magnetic flux density is below than 0.03 Tesla, which is very small. And this is the result. By changing the magnetic RPM from 320, 300, and 1,420 RPM, we can have a trimodal rotating locomotion. So in case of rotating at the origin, magnet has a very small diameter of the orbit, and for pivoting system, it has much larger, and then tumbling has even larger orbital radius. Okay, and from the top view, we can see this rotating is very small for orbit, and for pivoting, one side is lifted up and move to a different direction, and it has larger orbital radius. And speed is even faster. And for tumbling, now even you can see jumping behavior. So both ends can be have no contact with the substrate. And in this case, it's very fast because it's 100 times slower video, and the orbital radius is very large. When you watch soft robotic locomotion videos, it's usually accelerated like 8 times or 10 times, something like that. But in this case, because it's really fast, we utilize 100 times slower video than real time. Okay, as I showed you, different orbital radius originating from different magnet RPM, we can have different orbit velocity as well. And that's originated from the different locomotion mode, rotating, pivoting, and tumbling. And this orbital radius is coming from outward centrifugal force. So this is the revolution originated from the rotation of the helical soft robot. And here, even with a similar orbital radius, you can have different orbit speed. So the faster soft robot can catch up slower soft robot by having this 27 cycles of run. So if you look at the time dependent y-axis, it oscillates in y-axis. So you can see this oscillation in sinusoidal curve. And at the beginning it's in phase, but then in the middle it has out of phase. And then over the course of 27 orbit, eventually it will catch up the slower soft robot, and it is in phase again. So we are able to control the orbital velocity by utilizing different locomotion mode or different aspect ratio of soft robot. And as I mentioned, this is a very fast locomotion. In case of mammals or ants or arthropod, regardless of the body mass, look at this huge range of the body mass. It's the very large order of magnitude difference. But regardless of the body mass, if we utilize the same working system, so in this case, mammals and ants, they all walk. So walking nature, walking system has a very similar velocity in terms of body length per second. And even for snakes and earthworms, even though they have different size and body mass, the velocity in terms of body length per second is very similar. But considering the artificial robotic systems, walking rigid soft robot and walking soft robot, we have dramatic decrease in velocity by miniaturizing the size. So that means we are doing something wrong. But in case of our limbless soft robotic case, this is SpinBot, Even though it has very smaller body weight, even the reported very small soft robot, the speed-wise is 50,000 times faster and 7 times lighter than the most lightweight legged soft robot, not the limbless soft robot. Okay, so it's good that it can have faster locomotion, but also we can control the orbital radius as well. By having different size, it has different orbit and orbital radius and orbital velocity as a function of magnetic RPM. So at certain RPM, this blue one, aspect ratio 4, is at the outer part, but by changing the RPM, it goes to the center, and the one in the center, now it goes to the outward. Okay, so to understand this behavior, I had a collaboration with Professor Sana Kim at KAIST. He's in mechanical engineering. We observed that the soft robot exactly followed the magnetic RPM. So we assume that speed, rotational speed of magnet is equal to rotational speed of soft robot. And from that, we can calculate the distance, travel distance, and the velocity of the revolution. And then we assume that there will be slip in case of pivoting motion or tumbling motion. So rotating case, we don't have slip, but by having lifting angle, lift up angle, we start to have this slip behavior. So we introduce the error function to consider this probability of the slip. And that's the rotational speed dependent. And as I mentioned before, by utilizing the force balance between centrifugal force, outward centrifugal force, and inward magnetic attraction, we utilize this force balance equation. And by having the equations, we can calculate the orbital radius here as a function of magnetic RPM. And this trend line is showing the modeling case, and these markers are showing experimental data. And as you can see, it follows the experimental data with the prediction pretty well. Okay, and because we can have different orbital radius as a function of magnetic speed, at the beginning, this AR4 has the largest orbital radius, but then at 820, it goes to the middle like this. And as you can see, it has very repetitive, reproducible orbit radius. But by changing the RPM, now it goes to the center, and the other two goes to the outward, as you can see from this graph. Okay, so that is the orbital radius control in XY plane. But also, even in G-directional, obstacles are there. The soft robot can overcome this G-directional obstacle. So in case of very slippery continuous uphill, it doesn't have any problem to go up. Because magnetic stutter is below the substrate, that means by going up, the magnetic strength, magnetic flux density will go down. But still, this soft robot can go uphill even with some slip. And even in case of discrete steps, even though the edge of the soft robot is stuck at the edge of these steps, it didn't have any problem to climb the steps. And if we have really thin film, the surface tension of water will be very large to have actuation. But as you can see, this three-dimensional soft robot can't have any problem. It has no problem to work in underwater conditions. And it also can have above water swimming if we don't wait to it immerse into water because of the density. Right? Because of a hierarchical motility having simultaneous rotation and revolution. When it have the obstacles in the middle of its revolution orbit, by having rotation, it just go around its obstacle, even though I don't have any, I don't change any conditions. So this is a good example. I put linear boundary condition at the top and bottom, and the outer soft robot meets the linear boundary condition here, and it just follows this linear boundary conditions. But when there is no boundary condition anymore, it recovers its orbit. And in the middle, because it didn't meet any boundary conditions, it just rotates in the certain orbit over and over again. Okay, in artificial stomach, there are lots of three-dimensional wrinkles. So even though I just simply control the magnetic field to go down or in XY, right? But it can just simply overcome any XYZ directional three-dimensional wrinkles without any problem. So I don't have to control very delicately. I just want to go to the certain area I want to go. So this is artificial tumor target. Even various soft robots can reach the destination. And because of the this collective behaviors, these soft robots work together to transport 100 times heavier than its individual robot. And this work is published in Nature Communication last year. Okay, so this is the conclusion of the first part, and I'm going to skip reading these conclusions. And because of time, I'm going to try to briefly introduce the microarray part. So in case of polymer composite microarray, by adding a hard magnet inside the polymeric materials, even though it shows the actuation behaviors, you can see obviously the soft robot, these microarrays have different responses. They are not synchronized altogether because each individual pillar work as magnet and they interact each other. It's because of high coercivity of hard magnet. If we utilize soft magnet, we need to sacrifice the saturation magnetization at low magnetic external magnetic field, but we don't have this coercivity. And it's easier to have the synchronized behavior. But of course, as an engineer, we want to maximize the magnetic response. And also we want to have the synchronized uniform actuation as well. So the strategy is having alignment of magnetic particles in the, this micro pillar so that I can program this magnetic field direction with respect to the micro pillar geometry. So this is a randomly dispersed magnetic particle within the micro pillar. And this is the aligned along the short axis of this semi-cylinder. And this is the horizontally long axis alignment. And this is vertically aligned. And this is hybrid of vertical alignment plus horizontal long axis alignment. So I examined the five different cases. And this is showing the uniformity of alignment. You can see uniform pillar geometry and also it has alignment direction like this. It has hybrid of vertical and horizontal direction as well. And after making this microarrays, I utilized the magnetic actuation by regulating the distances between two permanent magnets so that I can change the magnetic field strength from 0.05 Tesla to 0.6 Tesla. And random case, because of random directionality, even though it can have reversible actuation and repeatable, but the directionality is quite random. And if we have the same alignment direction towards the magnetic field direction, even with 0.6 Tesla, there's no magnetic response at all. And by having vertical alignment, I was able to have large bending actuation But directionality-wise, it has very hard to control. It has bidirectional bending behaviors. So instead of having bidirectional bending, I utilize the slight tilt angle so that I can have one uniform directional bending behaviors. So even by just having 10 degrees of tilt angle, I was able to have this uniform bending actuation. So by programming magnetic particles alignment, I can generate twisting motion. This is top view and the bottom is side view. And even though the polymer is the same, particles are the same, same concentration and same mold for micropillar, but I only change the directionality of particle alignment. And in case of vertical alignment, I can have uniform bending behaviors and it's beautifully synchronized all together. And hybrid case, I can see bending and twisting at the same time. And this actuation is pretty uniform. Even though I tried 100 times, there's no difference at all. And this twisting or bending angle as a function of magnetic flux density is simulated by Dr. Seijin Lee at Lawrence Livermore National Lab. And we are able to fit the data with this model. So this is summarizing the actuation. And by using quadrupole magnetic field, I can program different alignment. And then I was able to have concerted actuation in a single sample. So because of the different magnetic field direction here, by having magnetic field, we can have different actuation, like a twisting, bending, and hybrid all in the same sample. And by using patterning technique, I can pattern two different alignments. The letters are vertically aligned and it has bending behaviors. And the other part has no response because it's aligned already in the same direction as magnetic field. So I can see reversible appearance and disappearance of these inha letters by having this microgeometry. And it has been known that you can have directional liquid spreading by having this tilt bent pillars. But that case, it doesn't have any reversible spreading behavior, but because we have reversible actuation, by having bending, we can have directional spreading. But if we recover the upright position, it stops there, it pin. And then if we have bending, it have actuation again. So we can on and off the this directional liquid spreading by having reversible actuation. And I'm gonna skip this part. Okay, so this is the conclusion. And I'd like to thank my students, Jisoo, Sukyoung, and Chung-eun, and my collaborators, Professor Sana Kim-Kaist, Dr. Sejin Park at Lawrence Livermore, Dr. Augustine Albers, and Dr. Jayong-gu at Air Force Research Lab, and Professor John Hart at MIT and Professor Hang Bo-jao at USC. And funding is from National Research Foundation of Korea and AFOSR, AORD. Thank you for your attention.